In this video, we are going to take a look at the additional sketching tools that are available to us in Autodesk Inventor. First, we'll look at some options for drawing circles. You should be familiar with the default circle command by now, but just in case, we'll look through it real quick here. We'll specify a center point of a circle, and while the command itself is called center radius, if you're typing in a value, you will actually be typing in the diameter value to place the circle. Now, additionally, I can create circles that are tangent to other objects. So for example, if I had a rectangle and I wanted a circle tangent to the three sides, I can click the drop down here and choose the tangent circle and then click three items for it to be tangent to. Next, we'll take a look at a few arc options. The default version of the arc command allows you to pick three points. The first and the second point are actually the endpoints of the arc, and the third point is a point somewhere on the arc. So again, I'll pick a first point in space, a second point in space, and then my third point is just going to be a point somewhere on the arc. The third point determines whether the arc is drawn clockwise or counterclockwise. This arc tool makes it really easy to draw tangent arcs. If I use the arc tool, I can pick two endpoints. Then I can bring it out until it's tangent, then click to place my third point. We've got several arc options we can use. We have the tangent arc as well. The tangent arc is another way that I can select the endpoint of a line and instantly create an arc tangent to it. So this is another way that I can create a tangent arc. Finally, we can also specify a center point. So if I select this version of the arc command, the status bar is first telling me to select a center point. So maybe I'll pick the midpoint of this line here. Then you can see a preview of the arc itself. I'll click a start point, and similar to the default arc command, the direction I move my mouse is what determines whether it's drawn clockwise or counterclockwise. So I'll go ahead and bring it down and around and click to place my last point there. Next, we'll take a look at the rectangle command, and I'm going to go ahead and just delete all of this sketch geometry here. The default version of the rectangle command allows you to pick two diagonal endpoints. I can specify the values as I'm placing them by tabbing between the boxes. So if I wanted a 2x1 rectangle, I can type 2, then tab to the other box, then enter in the value for that one, then press enter. You just want to make sure you tab between the boxes, not press enter, because that will actually finish the command. If we click the drop down under rectangle, you can see there's several different ways we can draw rectangles. We have a 3-point version, which just basically allows us to draw a rectangle at an angle. So I can specify 2 points to act as the bottom of the rectangle. Then I can specify a second point to place the rectangle. Keep in mind, I can come back in later with the dimension tool to dimension these and fully constrain them. Another rectangle option that I like to use a lot is the 2-point center. I often will like to start parts centered around the origin. This rectangle makes that very easy. You can select a center point for your rectangle, and you can see that it's going to create some construction lines and keep it centered around that point. Once again, I can type in a value and tab to the other box and press enter once I have my lengths in. Also underneath rectangle is the ability to do a similar 3-point center. Once again, centered around the origin, but it allows me to create one at an angle. We also have tools to create slot shapes. I basically specify the two center points, then the radius of the slot arcs. Once again, I can come in after the fact and dimension these to fully constrain them. There's a couple of different methods for drawing the slots. There's also the ability to draw curved slots as well. But let's look at the polygon command to finish up this dropdown. With the polygon command, we can create regular polygons that have three sides or more. We just simply specify how many sides we want. So let's say we wanted to draw an octagon. I'll put in 8 sides. Then you can specify if you want this to be inscribed or circumscribed. And that just controls where the polygon touches a conceptual circle. So if I have a circle with a diameter of 8, the circumscribed polygon is going to touch at the surfaces, whereas the inscribed will touch at the points. So the inscribed circle ends up being a smaller one than the circumscribed. That's really important in a program like AutoCAD. In Inventor, it's less important because we can actually just go ahead and add in our constraints after the fact to fully dimension it. We can also come back after the fact to add in things like horizontal constraints so that I can go ahead and line this up. We'll learn that in a future lesson. We'll take a look at a couple of tools for corner treatments, specifically some fillets and chamfers. The fillet tool is located here in the Create panel. I can specify a fillet value. When you specify the fillet value, you want to make sure that you don't press enter. It will actually close this dialog box if you do. Notice there's also an equal sign here. That will make all the fillets I create equal. So here you can see that I created one fillet. I can continue to go ahead and create additional fillets. And then I can just close the fillet tool when I'm done. Since the equal sign was active, all of these fillets are equal. So if I were to change this fillet to 2, for example, you can see that they all update. Alternatively, if I were to fillet and turn the equal sign off, then you can see that each corner is going to have its own unique dimension to drive that particular fillet. The chamfer command works fairly similarly. I'll go ahead and put a rectangle up here again. Click the drop down next to fillet and choose chamfer here. As you can see, we have the ability to add our dimensions and to make these chamfers equal, just like we did with the fillets. We have three different methods. We can have two similar distances, two different distances, or a distance and an angle. So I'll start with two similar distances. Let's say 1 inch on this example. I'll go ahead and come in here and click two lines. And as you can see, it adds the chamfer. Because I had the button turned on to create the dimensions, you can see the dimensions are there, and you can also see that the equal is on, so I can go ahead and add some additional chamfers. Notice the fx in the dimension. This indicates that it's a function, and it's basically equal to the first one. So if I were to come in and adjust my first chamfer value, you can see that all of the other ones update. A couple other methods for creating the chamfers. I can choose two distances. So maybe I want a 1x2 distance. It's important to note which one is distance 1. That value is going to come off of the first line that I click. So I'll click the vertical line, then the horizontal line. And you can see that the 1 inch was cut off of the first line that I selected. If I had selected them the opposite way, then I would have created this particular chamfer, and again, I can come in here and delete the other one if I want. So finally, maybe I just know a distance and an angle. So maybe I know that I want to come in 3 inches and I want a 30 degree angle line. I'll choose the third option here. I'll put in a value of 3 for my distance and 30 for my angle. The first line I click on is the one that's going to take 3 inches off. So I'll click on the horizontal line first, then the vertical. And as you can see, it created a chamfer that is 3 inches by 30 degrees. Let's look at one more sketch editing tool, the mirror command. So I'll start by creating some sort of shape here that I can mirror. I'm not going to worry about fully constraining it at this point in time. And then in order to mirror something, I need a mirror line. So I'm going to create a line right down the middle here. Then I can go ahead and choose the mirror command from the pattern section here. So first I'll select the geometry that I want to mirror. So I'll click and drag to select the geometry here. Then I'll click the mirror line button. Then I'll click this line in the center, then apply. As you can see, not only did it mirror it, it created a bunch of symmetric constraints here. So it has a relationship with the original. If I come in here and adjust the original, you can see that the mirror image updates for us. Now, one thing to note on mirrors, fillets, and chamfers, currently we're looking at the sketch versions of these commands. There are actually feature versions as well. So after I've extruded and made a solid part, I can actually fillet in the 3D mode and chamfer, and I can also mirror features in the 3D mode as well. Typically, that workflow works a little bit better, as we'll see later, because we'll end up with a separate feature in our browser for each one that makes it a little bit easier to go back and edit fillets and chamfers and modify mirrors if we need to. That concludes this look at some additional sketching tools in Autodesk Inventor.